Sri Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, who is the best foremost Vedantist, and Sam, to my beloved Shikshi Guru Dev. Sri Bhaktivedanta Narayana Goswami Maharaj is also the foremost Vedantist, and his Guru Dev also. Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami Maharaj is being glorified as someone who knows all Vedanta, and his institution was called Gaudiya Vedanta Samiti. It's not for no reason. And I will remind one of the teaching of Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami. I hope I'm not going to forget. Talking about Nirguna and Saguna Brahma, because this is also in the upcoming sutras. I noticed actually, you know, in that picture of Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada is smiling. He knows that
it's on.
To try to present such a big subject. It's like almost a futile attempt, and yet he's happy to hear how you can present the right Vedanta, the Bhakti Vedanta, and not the Vedanta that everybody is accustomed to hear. You are me, I am you, everybody is one, and we are happy. And he's also smiling because Vedanta, like the joke he was making, Vedanta, without teeth, it will knock all your teeth out, because it's such a hard subject. If you try to chew on it before swallowing it, then it may knock your teeth out. Not in the literal sense, but it is not an easy subject. It is, but it is something needed to understand to some degree. And we can present it very, 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 very simply. But then how do we get the some indication of this depth, of this, you know, the deep aspect, and all the different commentaries that can be made? It's like a vast ocean, and we can only hope to present one drop of that vast ocean, just like Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is called the ocean of Bhakti Ras. And Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur made a commentary based on that, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu Bindu, just a drop of this. And I remember one lecture that Srila Gurudev was giving. He was talking about Rupa Shiksha, and he says, Rupa Goswami, he has tasted only a drop of that ocean and presenting only a drop to the world. And he said, my Guru Maharaj also has tasted one drop. And he said, myself, Gurudev said, myself, I haven't tasted the drop. But I smell the breath that come from the ocean, just smelling the breath, you know, and this was sufficient. And this is what I'm bringing you, he said. And it's just the breath. It's like here, you can smell the ocean. And just that may be enough to, of course, better drown in Bhakti Ras and Vedanta Ras, but still, one and the other, actually there's no differentiation. It's not like, Prabhupada was saying very often that philosophy without religion is just mental speculation. Religion without philosophy is only sentiment, and at best, sentiment, otherwise fanatism. And we see in the world how some people are embracing the faith with fanatism. They cannot even explain why their religion is good, or what is it giving them. Oh, I was told that if I die for God, then I'll go to paradise, and 50 virgin girls are waiting for me. So on that pretext, and I explode myself in the public place and kill everybody alone. And they think that this is a very deep subject, and they are convinced that they will be rewarded for this. It's a horrible conception. So the two are needed. It is very important. Otherwise, how can you understand really what everything is saying? You need some basic foundation, some philosophical foundation, and you need some ras. Otherwise, you become all dry up. How can you continue if there was no, like Maharaj was saying the other day, if you didn't have all these different stories about Krishna, how could you go on chanting? How could you go on chanting if you didn't remember all these beautiful pastimes? From time to time, we are supposed to remember them as we chant, but even if we don't, this is also helping us to go on to the ras. We need the ras. What is the? I asked this question in the beginning. What is philosophy? You answer different and various and interesting answers. I also want to ask, what is the use of philosophy? Why do we want to study any philosophy? Love of wisdom. Philosophia. Love of wisdom. Why? What does it give us?
Well, it can help us to understand our goal and how to have right behavior.
Goal and right behavior.
To achieve the goal.
Yes. Okay. Very good.
Pacifies our intellect. Simultaneously, if we have an inspiration, it's giving us some intellectual support or confidence.
Yeah.
Insanity. Not insanity.
Okay, insanity. Okay. Confidence, you become sane.
Yeah.
Anandamayo vyasa.
That is the goal. That was the next question. The goal of philosophy. What is the goal of philosophy? To make you happy, yes. What is it? Yes. In a nutshell, to help to think clearer. We are very confused in our mind and we try to think better and more clearer about what we believe, about what is the goal of life, about who are we, and so on and so forth, and clear out the doubts. That is what the philosophy is made of, not to make your head more big headache because you don't understand the question that is being asked. That is more like insanity. We don't need this. There's enough of that. To become sane, that is a pretty good thing, because actually people will lose their minds because they don't know what the truth is anymore. You know, when you are confronted with people who are totally illogical, or who have twisted in their brain, you're trying to argue with them, and because they are so confused, sometimes you become confused yourself. Like, am I living in a mad world or what? You know, I'm trying to say something that seems to be so understandable, and he doesn't understand or she doesn't understand, and you feel like you can go crazy. So philosophy helps you. Okay, maybe with certain people it's just enough just to say one thing simple. Prabhupada was saying, for many people you just chant Hare Krishna, you give them prasad. Don't try to explain to them Brahman, Bhagavan, Paramatma, and the soul and the transmigration. Just chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, and you give them a little prasad.
Many times this was Prabhupada's approach.
Yes.
These people cannot understand philosophy.
No.
Just chant Harinam and distribute.
And also you can distribute books, because the books, the philosophy is in the books. People can sit at home and read and argue with the book and so on, but then eventually they still go on reading, they will understand something. And if you argue with someone, it just doesn't go anywhere, so better drop the argument and chant.
You also have different levels of knowledge.
Yes.
Which people learn. Who is simple-hearted, ignorant person, he may not understand the higher philosophy.
Of course.
But he may understand simple philosophy.
Yes.
And that is his confirmation that he is happy or whatever he is.
Simple philosophy, you may say it's Bhagavad Gita, but it's not that simple. But what I really love is that I was always asking myself, what is the soul? What is it in this body that is called the soul? You know, in Christianity they speak about the soul, but they cannot explain what it is. And they describe it like a little bird that flies somewhere and then you can come back and that survive after the body, I have a hard time understanding what is this comparison, where does it come from, and what is inside my body, and I am the body. And right from the beginning, Bhagavad Gita explained, Dehi nosmi nyata dehi komaram yogaram jarat tata deham parapratis dhira tarasna muyati. And this is the first verse I learned, actually. And it's great, you know, your body is changing, it's growing, it's not the same body, I'm not a child anymore. I'm not supposed to. The body is not childish anymore, and then not the boyhood body, not the youth body, and it keeps on changing. Even if something inside is always remaining, consciousness is there, memory is there, you may lose also your memory. That becomes a little more complicated when you become Alzheimer and you don't even remember who you are. That becomes a little more complicated, but that is a very proof that who you are depends on your memory more than on your body. You can lose your arms, you can lose many things of your body, you can have fake teeth. See, Vedanta with fake teeth, that is great, because then they cannot break anymore. That's a good advertisement, you know? Learn Vedanta with new teeth. But anyway, this is beginning knowledge which is already very deep, because right from the beginning you have the answer of all the world religion. You are not this body, you're transmigrating, and you're a very tiny, tiny, tiny soul within, and then there's a great soul. So, so far, we've seen how to inquire about Brahman and how Brahman can be described, and it is described by Shastra, and Shastra has to be read thoroughly with investigation and comparison between this text and that text, and then certainly Brahman can be described by words, it is not inexpressible. And then the sutra, starting sutra 6 to 11, speak about the subject according to Madhvacharya and Baladev Vidyabhushana. The other continue with the same subject of Pradhan, Samkhya, which is interesting. But like Madhva was saying, why do we need to speak about this now? Because it's going to be refuted, this Sankhya philosophy, in the fourth part, the entire part of the first chapter. There's no need to speak of it now. We can go on in the same subject about Shastra. So they say, Gaunashchen Natma Shabdat. And I just read this second translation, which means, if you say that Brahman is described by word, is Brahman covered by material guna? The answer is no, because the text mentioned the word Atma in relation to Brahman. Because this Ikshata Bahusyam, titled Ikshata Bahusyam, or some other verse mentioning the word Atma, this an equation between Brahman and Atman in the Upanishad. Not meaning that the soul and God is one, but meaning that Atma can be also a synonym of Brahma. You can say in the beginning, like some of the Upanishad, there was only Atma. This Paramatma, not us, you know, we are not the creator, obviously. So, this Mayavada philosophy is saying that, yes, it is true, there's a creator of the world, he's called Ishwara, the God, the small God, you may call it Brahma or Narayan, whatever names you give it anyway. It doesn't matter because it's all one. Ultimately, this Brahman, this creator you're talking about is Saguna Brahma, covered with the material quality. Especially he's in Sattva-gun. He's not influenced by Tamagun or by Rajagun, but by Sattva-gun. So, taking this as the first proposal, Purva Paksha, the Siddhanta is, if you say that Brahman is described by word, is the Saguna Brahma, the answer is no. Because text mentioned the word Atma, and Atma means Brahma, it's the same thing. So this is the proposal that is given by Madhvacharya. Then, yes.
But do Shankaracharya also accept the two meaning as the same? Which Atma is equal Brahman, Brahman is equal Atma, and they speak like this?
No.
Then it becomes very complicated.
No, they accept that Atma means Brahma in the sense that Atma, small Atma, means big Brahma. Whatever is Atma in your soul, whatever is your Atma is equal to Brahma. That is the understanding of Shankaracharya. When you say trying to discover the self within you,
it does not accept that Brahma can be individual in any way.
No, there's no individuality, it's an illusion, an upadhi. It is a material covering that we saw yesterday, an upadhi. No, we don't agree. That's obvious that there's two different proposals. We don't agree. This idea of Saguna Brahma and Nirguna Brahma is not in it's not in the Upanishad. You don't find it anywhere.
What?
This idea of Saguna Brahma and Nirguna Brahma it's not in the Upanishad.
It's Shankara's personal invention.
Yes, there are some Upanishads among the 108 Upanishads which are definitely Advaita Upanishad, meaning written after Shankaracharya, just to confirm his idea. But if we take them to the letter, they say that 11 Upanishads are called really Vedic and most ancient. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, Titiriya Upanishad, Etariya Upanishad, Isha Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad, Mandukya Upanishad, Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Mandukya I mentioned, Katta Upanishad,
Kena
Upanishad,
Shvetashvatara.
I mentioned Shvetashvatara already. I have 10. Not bad.
Almost.
So anyway, those Upanishads I consider to be topmost and most ancient. Then, in a Mukti Upanishad, 108 Upanishads are named. And among them you have this 11 main Upanishads, then you have also Yoga Upanishads. And then you have Sannyas Upanishad. Upanishads that talk only about Sannyas. And Parivrajacharya Upanishad, for Paramahamsa Upanishad, Jabala Upanishad, all these Upanishads that talk also about the supreme goal of man's life. This is really man who takes sannyas. Then you have also Shivaita Upanishad. Then you have Vishnu Upanishads, those that are dedicated to. So you have a Krishna Upanishad, the Gopal Tapani Upanishad. And different others, Vasudeva Upanishad, they're called Vaishnava Upanishads. So you have 108 Upanishads.
When you say they consider some of most ancient, then who was writing the other? If you say some ancient, but means not the same writer.
That, so. You know, ancient is mentioned by scholars.
No.
Shankaracharya mentioned 11 Upanishad as being Vedic, close to the Veda. But all of the Upanishad mentioned in this Mukti Upanishad 108 are considered Shruti anyway. But of course, many scholars and many impersonalists will not accept Vasudeva Upanishad, or which resemble more tantric work, or Gopal Tapani Upanishad, where the not the Kama Gayatri is given, but the Gopal Mantra is given. So some of the Upanishads are considered like less important to them. We don't consider, but they consider like this. So if you want to argue on their ground, you have to argue with the Shastra that they recognize. They recognize Bhagavad Gita, they recognize all these Upanishads. And like I said, among the 11 Upanishad, at least three or four are considered theist because they mention Purusha. That is Katha Upanishad, Shweta Ashvatara Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad, Isha Upanishad. Those are Isha. There's the words. The word Isha. From the word Isha Vasha Idam Sarvam, everything belongs to Ishvara. So they are considered theistic Upanishad. They describe. And Shvetashvatara Upanishad describes some kind of bhakti, describing also Maheshwaram, the proprietor of Maya, the word Maya appears only in this Upanishad, among the oldest one, or the prior one. It doesn't appear anywhere else, and in the sense of a Shakti, and not in the sense of how Shankaracharya is giving. Shankaracharya was influenced by his Param Gurudev, Gaudapada. Actually, he didn't really follow his own Gurudev, Govinda. He followed his Param Gurudev, Gaudapada, who wrote a karika on the Mandukya Upanishad, only 8 verses, but he gives all this definition that the world is a dream, and you have to wake up from this dream, and he gives this comparison of the rope and the snake and the pot with the air within the pot and all these things that Shankara and his followers are always using. So he's been influenced by this, and Gaudapada's philosophy is very close to the Buddhist, Himalayan Buddhist, you know, this tantric Buddhist called Vidyanavada. Everything is an illusion, it's only in your mind. There's two main current in the Himalayan Buddhism, Vidyanavada and Shunyavada. One is claiming that the world is just an hallucination of your mind. It's projected. This Tibetan Book of the Dead is what it's speaking about. Everything is projected. It's not all that crazy. It says that when you're dying, some beautiful deity come to you and they are helping you to achieve liberation. And then if you're afraid of them, then some very, very fearful a deity appear in front of you, they are the projection of your own fear, of your own anger, of your own, you know, so it's also psychological. But ultimately you have to identify yourself with the deity and merge into that deity and merge into the white light. This is what the Tibetan Book of the Dead is saying. And Shunyavad, ultimately, the Dalai Lama is always speaking about Shunyavad. Everything is void. There's no reality at all, because everything is changing constantly, so the reality is nil, and since there's no Atma anywhere, it's Shunyavad, there's no Atma anywhere, nothing is actually transcending this temporariness. The only absolute is that everything is temporary and
void,
ultimately void. So Nirvishesha Shunyavad, this is some depressive philosophy that Srila Prabhupada and all the Vaishnava Acharya, they're fighting against, because this like hopeless philosophy of nothing can be achieved. And the philosopher, this German philosopher who wrote on the Upanishad, what's his name?
Schopenhauer.
Very depressing.
There is one very humorous way of cutting the argument of such a nihilist who says, there's nothing, everything is always changing, everything is always changing. So you can say, yeah, so you're saying everything is always changing. Yes, everything is always changing. And then you can say, so this element of always.
Huh?
So this element of always.
Yes, there's an element of eternity.
Yes. there we go.
There's an element of eternity in your permanency.
Prabhupada, so what is Shunyavadi? Prabhupada said one time, the only void they will attain is the void of their intelligence.
That's preaching with an axe stick.
I told one time this phrase in a class, and 2 person Buddhists, they came up.
They stood up and left. So this is how we treat Buddhists, don't I better go back in my cave. Anyway, Buddhism, we were talking about it a little before, Buddhism, Shankaracharya, nevertheless, it still has some positive aspect. I mean, in today's world, like I said before, Buddhism means only, I just want to breathe. Just want to sit down and have some peace. Most people who practice or claim to be Buddhist in the West, they don't want to achieve nirvana. They just want to have some peace of mind, because their mind is always agitated. So they do this vipassana meditation just to have some peace, and that's it. And they like the idea that they are not a dogmatic teaching, except for the Nerarmya. This is very dogmatic in them. Once I told them, I said, you're claiming you don't have any dogma. What about this Nerarmya, that there is no soul? Why are you so stubborn in pretending that there's nothing transcending and nothing that can transmigrate? They may negate God, okay, to some atheists out there, but why do they have to negate the soul that they believe in reincarnation? And they're very dogmatic about this. But otherwise, it is a religion or a philosophy. See, people are always arguing. The Western scholars, they, in the 19th century, they said, Buddhism is not a religion, it is a philosophy. So then people are always asking this question, is it philosophy or is it religion? Well, you know, it's because people don't understand that in India both are linked. Like I said, a religion without philosophy is only sentimentalism, and philosophy without religion is only speculation. So you have to have both. In India, this is how they do. For every religious, because we will always have to bear in mind that the greatest religion, two of the greatest religions in the world come from India. Buddhism and what they call Hinduism.
If they don't believe in Atma, but they believe in reincarnation, Who's reincarnated?
That's the question. That is the question that they cannot answer. They have so many different answers, which I'm not going to go into, because this is refuted in the second chapter of Vedanta Sutra. They refute the four kinds of Buddhist philosophy. So now, coming back to the sutra, the next sutra reads, Tan Nishtaya Moksha Upadeshat. The Lord is not a manifestation of Satvagun, as the Mayavad say, because the scripture teach that the person who worships the Lord attains liberation from the guna. It will be a contradiction if you can't be free from the guna, and you worshipping Saguna Brahma, how can he liberate you from the guna? And one argument they're giving, Srila Madhvacharya, I think Baladev Vidyabhushana is saying the same thing, that according to Shankar, the Manuvakya, Tatvamasi, meaning you are that. And we speak about Sat, what is existent, meaning Pradhan. If you say you are that, Pradhan, it equals to say you are unintelligent, just like you just said, the void of your philosophy, the void of your brain. So if you say Pradhan of the Sankhya philosophy, the unmanifested nature, is Sat, it is real, it is the origin of creation. And you say along, Tattvamasi, that means you are that, meaning Pradhan, meaning you are unintelligent. Because Pradhan is not intelligent. It is dead matter. You understand that? Yeah. They like to play on this different. You may say it's just ridiculing your opponent. Okay. It doesn't come from Baladev Vidyabhushana. Madhvacharya.
How Shankara viewed reincarnation as she asked the question?
Shankara,
the Buddhist say it's a mental, the mental trick actually. But how Shankaracharya viewed this?
But as long as you are conditioned, sharirak, if you are in the body, then you will go on transmigrating until you realize you are that one, tattvamasi aham brahmasmi sarvaka vidam brahma. All these different Mahavakya, so it's same explanation as we can give. But it's ultimately made on the mental plane. The Buddhists, they don't say it's the mind or the mental image that makes you transmigrate. It's only in the Tibetan Book of the Dead that it says that. And the Tibetan Book of the Dead is a late work which was influenced by Tantra and by Yoga. It's actually, they call it Yogacara. The branch of Yogacara in Buddhism, influenced also by Vijnanavana, Shunyavada, many things. Shiva religion also, because all these different deities they represent. Really, when you see all this you're not supposed to look if you're a brahmachari, you know, this God embracing is Shakti and everything, this, because this is a tantric understanding, this Himalayan Buddhism. But you, really, when you look at the face and the tankas, you know, that they present, you know, it is Shiva and Parvati, or Shiva or Shakti. This is coming from India also. It's all a big mixture. So then they came up with this Yogacara, actually, is a Buddhist branch that accepted yoga as the most important thing. So they say, what transmigrate? It's your last thought. Like Bhagavad Gita is saying. But ultimately, they don't believe in soul, which is a contradiction. It's yes? Question? No. Okay.
Yeah, I just want to know again the translation of Sutra 6, because you're not a bit too fast.
Oh, it's too fast. That if you say that Brahman is covered, Sarguna Brahma, this is the argument of Mayavad. Ishvara, the creator, is Sarguna Brahma, covered by the guna. We say no, na, atma shabda, because of the word atma that is used in Upanishad, and atma equal Brahman, not anything else, not sarguna Brahman, it's vishuddhatma. That's the argument of Madhvacharya. Now the translation of Shankaracharya and Ramanuja is different. If I give you two translations simultaneously, you become confused which one is which. And they continue by saying, the proof that it is not Saguna is that this Lord of creation can give you liberation, moksha, upadesh. The instruction about moksha is given. So how can you say that this Brahma is Saguna? So they are saying, Madhvacharya and Bharata Vidyabhushana are saying that this Brahma of creation is actually Nirguna. But then they are saying in a sutra following that he has some spiritual quality. This what you call Ubaya Lakshana. Ramanuja Acharya brought that into consideration. Brahman has two characteristics. He is devoid of all material qualities like sleepiness and greediness and hunger and thirst and evil and all these things he's totally devoid of. And he's also full of spiritual quality because Ramanuja Acharya was getting his inspiration from Vishnu Purana, then he's conceiving Brahman as being Bhagavan. He has all the different opulence, so all the good quality, fame and beauty first, that comes, everything comes from beauty, because he's beautiful, he's fascinating to everyone, his name is Krishna, that's how Prabhupada will translate Krishna, he's fascinating to everyone. So he has the most beautiful qualities. If you call him Saguna, meaning he has all, and that's what the Bhagavatam is saying. The Bhagavatam, when you read some verses, you have many verses saying he's both Saguna and Nirguna. They always play with this. So many verses are saying like this. Aneka Guna, Ananta Guna. He has unlimited good quality. Sattvam Rajas Tamaiti Nirgunasya Gunastraya. He's nirguna of the three guna, but he also is full of some guna of his own. Anadir atma purusho nirguna prakriti para. He's nirguna, really. This atma, see the word atma is used in the relationship with God, purusha. This anadir doesn't have a beginning, and he's nirguna, and he's prakriti para, above this prakriti. Nirgunaya Guneshaya Namo Brahmanya Devaya Trigunaya Namo Namaha. He's made the Triguna, but at the same time he's above the Triguna. He makes the Triguna. In the third canto, Atma Tattva Bodhena Viragena Dridanicha Iyate Bhagavan Ibi Saguna Nirguna Svadrik. He's both Saguna and Nirguna. This is an interesting aspect of the Bhagavatam, who is a natural commentary on Vedanta Sutra, to say that he's both. He's full of the best of qualities. Everything that you want as a quality, he has. And everything you don't want as a bad quality he doesn't have. So he's perfect Lord. Srila Bharata Vidya Bhushan is quoting this verse also from Bhagavatam. Hariri Guna Saksha Purusha Prabhiti Para Sasa Vadri Gupadrashta Tambhajan Nirguna Upale. Yes?
So, what is the translation of number 6 by the Vaishnavas? Are they saying, if you say?
Yes, if you argue, this is from Baladev Vidya Bhushana. If you argue that Brahman described by words is Brahman covered by material gunas, the answer is no, the na, because the text mentioned the word Atma in relation to Brahman. That is his translation.
So the Shabda means what here?
Shabda only is a word. Shabda means a word.
Okay.
It can mean scripture, it can be his word, it can mean vibration, but in that context it means the word. Atma, Shabdat, long A with the T, it's actually the ending of the ablative case, like I say, most of the, you know, there's, you know, German, they understand, they have this derivation, also Russian, or in English and French, we don't have.
So Madhvacharya was before Shankaracharya?
No, after. Shankara, it's about 500 years difference. Ramanujacharya comes after 12th century, Madhvacharya 13th century, like that. And Shankaracharya 6th, maybe or 7th, nobody knows.
800?
Long time before. So Shankaracharya's influence has been there greatly in India. Everybody is so much appreciative of him having reintroduced the meaning of the Veda Upanishads, and to have reconciled all the differences between the different worship, because people were worshipping either Ganesh or Vishnu or Shiva or Durga or the sun god, and he says, now you can work, there's this five. Panchopasana comes from Shankaracharya, actually. He encouraged this, you know, according to Smriti, all these gods you can worship, no problem. They are Purana glorifying Vishnu, glorifying Shiva, glorifying Durga, glorifying Ganesh, glorifying. So it's all part, manifest Brahman. That is his understanding. Saguna Brahman is manifest Brahman. He's not saying it's Maya. He's not saying it's Maya. It manifests in order to save you, to rescue you. But it's only a tool in order to contain something else. It's like this example of the Buddhist giving sometimes. It's also in the Bhagavatam somewhere. But if you want to cross the river, you take a floating raft, and or a boat. Once you achieve the other, you know, side, then you discard this, you don't need it anymore. So similarly, they are saying that we are using multi, the deity worship, just to attain to the other side. Once you attain to the other side, which is the Parabrahma, which is Nirvishesha, Nirguna, and Nirvakara, and Nirshakti, then you can reject all these other things. You don't need anymore. But of course Vaishnava think that it is a very offensive thing to do, because there's no difference between, if the Lord can come down in this material world, he doesn't have to put on some Sattvic Guna. Krishna comes as Satchitananda Vigraha. He has this form full of Satchitananda. It is not covered, even though he leaves a material body when he leaves this world, to confuse the people. So they may think, yes, we knew that it was a material body that he has assumed, and the real form has come back and merged into the big one. Because they have to recognize Krishna. Krishna speaks Bhagavad Gita, and Srimad Bhagavatam can also contain some verses that are Advaitin. And Sridharaswami gave explanation of some verses that can be impersonalist, our Guru, the Shastri Guru, Jiva Goswami Pad, he said, have given the quotes of Sridharaswami, the commentator of Srimad Bhagavatam, only when it doesn't disagree with the right Siddhanta, when it is touched by Advaita, left out, he said. in this Sandarbha. Because so they can read Srimad Bhagavatam, Mayavad, and saying, yes, you see, there's some verses which are describing. There's actually a verse from the Bhagavatam describing, Shukadev is saying at the end to Parikshit Maharaj that you are like some air in a pot, and the pot is broken, and then you're back with a big. The same thing as I said yesterday. So when you read this out of context, because if you do samanvaya, you can say yes, but then a few verses before, a few verses later, you're speaking about bhakti. So then you have to reconcile all these things, not take it just one verse. And this verse, Vedanta Sutra, he talks about this advaya paratattva, this non-dual. Sri Jiva Goswami gives this as evidence of his sandarbha. What is tattva sandarbha? Tattva sandarbha is to explain that the only scripture, shastra, that is worth studying in Kali Yuga is Srimad Bhagavatam, and he gives different evidence. We will have to give the seminar on tattva sandarbha because this is much more easier to understand than Vedanta and very valuable. And then the second part of his tattva sandarbha, he has six sandarbha. The first one is called tattva sandarbha, establishing the truth and establishing the subjects of all the other sandarbha. Then he's quoting that verse that is essential to him about the absolute truth. Yes, they say, Vedanti, it's in the plural, tattva-vidas, those who have seen the truth, they say, yajnanam advayam, they speak about advaya. The truth is advaya made of jnana. This advaya jnana can be described, shabdyate, in three ways, brahmeti, paramatmeti, bhagavan iti. There's only one reality, that is Krishna, and it can be perceived as Brahman, Paramatma, or Bhagavan. Brahman is just a general meaning, Bhagavan more specific. That is the only difference. You know, there's only Jiva Goswami who said that. He actually opened our eyes to the verse, the key verse of the Bhagavatam, because some scholars, they go and look up this verse and say, but Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan, they're just synonyms. Like many places in Bhagavatam, they used all these three synonyms. That doesn't mean the gradation. But because Jiva Goswami has studied thoroughly the Bhagavatam, he has come to this verse saying, this is the key vision that they shamsar kalapumsa Krishna's do Bhagavan's will. But Krishna, of all this incarnation, he is Swayam Bhagavan, he is himself Bhagavan. And this Bhagavan, according to Vishnu Purana, there's a big pages and passage in Vishnu Purana describing the word Bhagavan, what it means, how is it used, and this verse describing the qualities, Ishvarya, Samagrasya, and so on. So Bhagavan actually can be applied to an exalted soul. Bhagavan Narada, for example, it means sir, really. Not literally, but it means it could be addressed like sir and or lord. And because sometimes you can say my lord to some exalted personality without being God himself. So this idea of Krishna being his Bhagavan, being superior, brings to mind that Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti is just a gradation. Because Bhagavan is the ultimate, and Bhagavan is fully described in the 10th canto, the Ashraya. He's the shelter and the goal of all our inquiry about Brahman. We have to inquire about Brahman. Brahman is described as Bhagavan. Actually, Jiva Goswami, then he's saying, I'm going to describe the Brahman aspect, the Paramatma aspect, and the Bhagavan aspect in my Sandarbha. This is going to be called Sambandha. So the following Sambandha after Tattva Sambandha is Bhagavat Sandarbha. And Sri Jiva Goswami makes an equation between Bhagavat or Bhagavan and Brahman. Because he says that Bhagavan is only the more specific description of Brahman. Brahman is general. Then Paramatma Sandarbha follows after that, describing the Jiva and the indwelling super soul. Then Krishna Sandarbha is Bhagavan. And in that Krishna Sandarbha, Sri Jiva Goswami is giving this key verse. Itesham Shakara Pumsa Krishna Stu Bhagavan Swayam. An entire chapter describing why is it called Bhagavan. Why actually some people are saying no, people from Madhvacharya line, they deny, no, this verse doesn't mean that Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan. And he defeats all the arguments saying, no, this is like Paribhasha Sutra. In any work there's a sutra that is given that gave the synopsis of the entire book. This is the Paribhasha Sutra in the Bhagavatam. And it actually described that Krishna is the origin of all the different avatar. It's been described all the avatar, then Krishna is too. Bhagavan Swayam. So you have this understanding of a gradation. And Brahman can be understood more intimately as you go on this gradation. For now, the Acharya in our line are trying to describe Saguna Nirguna Brahma. And this is the appearance day of Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami. He was described as the Vedanta Acharya also. He knew Vedanta so well. And actually Srila Gurudev, he told me that he was translating this Vedanta Sutra because it was pleasing to his Gurudev. He wanted. And in one occasion Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami was describing why we worshipping Black Krishna and White Radha or White Gauranga, because he was saying that blackness means Nirguna. It has no color. Colors can be also the definition of Guna. You know, Sattva is yellow, Rajas is red. It's described in Shvetashvata Upanishad. And Tamas is dark blue or black. And so the blackness of Krishna signifies that he is Nirguna. He has no color, no guna. And the whiteness of Radha signifies that she is Saguna. She has all the most beautiful qualities, because white is a combination of all the colors. And it's also Gauranga. Gauranga who came to give this sound vibration. Same thing if you want to understand Vedanta Sutra according to Samanvaya, you study the beginning and the end shlok, not shlok, but sutra. Atato Brahma Jigyasa, now is the time to understand Brahman, general meaning. Then Anaviti Shabda. What is Shabda? In that sense, Shabda means sound vibration. No more coming back by chanting. This chanting is going to liberate you. So Gauranga Mahaprabhu is going to give this chanting and is actually liberating all the living entity, making them go back or go for the first time, if we understand rightly, to the spiritual realm. It's okay? You following? Tan nishtaya mokshopadesh vibdam. Itaya bachanascha. I'm going to go a little further. Swapyaya, it says that the Lord can actually merge into Himself. This is the ninth, actually. The Lord is not covered with material quality because He merged into Himself, not into something else. Srila Baladeva Vidyabhushana quotes from the Vajrasadneya portion of the Yajurveda, but it's also the invocation of Ishopanishad. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnam Purnamudashyate Purnasyam Purnamadaya Purnamidavashishyate. Yes.
7 and 8.
Yeah, because they talk about Nirguna Brahma. I can give you the translation later on, but I will never go beyond this first 12 verses, and I want to cover the first chapter. You know, last year I already talked about the same thing. So they're not as important sutra. They are important if you want to take literally the injunction of Gurudev to learn the first 10 sutra, but they're not important to our topic because they're speaking about the same thing about Nirguna Brahma. So I'm just reading the translation that Srila Bhaktivedanta Vidyabhushana is making of that verse because it's a little different than what we used to hear. He's saying Om Purnamada Purnaminama. We have this reading that the material world is coming from the fool, and so the material world is just as full as the Brahman, what it comes from, the Lord, what it comes from, and the Lord doesn't lose anything. But this is how Srila Bharatiya is translating it, and this is translated by Banuswami after into English. The unmanifest Brahman is perfect, the manifested Brahman is perfect. From the unmanifested Brahman appears the manifest Brahman as various avatar. When the manifest form emerges from the unmanifested Brahman, the unmanifested Brahman remains. Because you're not reading it, so it's a little more difficult. But he's saying, against Shankaracharya, saying that Saguna Brahman is a manifestation of Brahman which is of a lower quality. He's saying, no, manifested Brahman is actually the full, Purna Brahman, just like where it manifested from. And both are full. The avatar is full and also the avatari.
But who is the avatar?
Complete. Huh?
Who is the avatar?
Who?
Who is the avatar?
Here, all the avatars.
I mean, everyone?
Yes. No. This is Baladev Vidyabhushana, giving. He's a Vaishnava, so all the avatar, Vishnu avatar, not us.
Yeah.
Yes. So all these avatar come from. He's want to make the point that the unmanifested Brahman you're saying is the Parabrahma. From Parabrahma come this what you call Aparabrahma or Saguna Brahma, the manifested Brahma, but it's just as complete or Purna, not full in the sense of crazy.
Complete.
So complete Brahma comes from the complete Brahma. And it's the equation is like 1 minus 1 doesn't equal 0. In that case, it's still equal 1. Just like 0 is a perfect number because you can subtract 0 from 0 and add 0 to 0 and multiply, always make 0. But 1 in that case is the same thing. 1 plus 1 equal 1, 1 minus 1 equal 1, 1 multiplied by 1 is always 1 because this is the Purna Brahma. See, this is just to show how the Acharya are so clever in describing what is Brahma, not only dwelling on this, okay, you have Brahma means the big one. Shrutatvacha, this is number 11. This is just one word. Shruta. And cha means and also a shruti of saying. You find in shruti also some evidence that he's quoting Shruta Upanishad, the Purusha, the Antaryami. I want to come to this Anandamayo Vyasat. Leave me a little time with this Anandamayo Vyasat. Ananda is bliss. What is Mayo? It's not Maya, it's Maya. No, it's not full. Purna is full. What is one is attached to something? One is Anamaya, Pranamaya, Anandamaya, Inatitariya, Upani. What does it mean?
Nature.
Qualities of,
nature.
Made of, yes. Anandamaya means made of, quality of
character,
Ananda.
Characteristic
is more specific, but made of, yes.
But it's the same word as Pranamaya, Anandamaya.
Yes, it comes from there.
Moya, it's just Moya or Ma?
No, it's Maya.
We say Chinmaya also.
Chinmaya, made of Chin.
Moya is Bengali.
Huh?
Moya is Bengali.
Yes, Moya is Bengali. It's M-A-Y-A. Like Maya, but Maya has long A. So, different word. So, Abhyasat. Arjuna is saying, this yoga of yours is much too difficult to perform, and Krishna is answering, Abhyasa to Kuntriya Vairagya Nasha Griyate. What is Abhyasa? That is the mistake that those who change the words in Bhagavad Gita made. They translate it by practice, but it's not in the old version of Bhagavad Gita by Prabhupada gives the right definition. Abhyasa doesn't mean practice. What does it mean?
Constant
or repetition. Because once I was giving a Bhagavad Gita lecture in the temple, and I had this old version, so I was saying by constant practice and by renunciation, and say, why are you saying constant practice? Because it says suitable practice. It changed it by suitable. Why? It's not the meaning. Why have they changed it by suitable and constant practice doesn't mean the same thing. Suitable means, oh, I have the right practice, so I can do it whenever I like. But constant means you have to endeavor. So practice, yes, is part of the meaning, but the suitable was actually introduced. Repetition is the meaning of abhyas. Abhyasat in the ablative, because made of ananda. This is the literal translation. But
that means 24 hours.
Yes.
Constant.
Yes.
Without interruption.
Yes, without interruption.
So the translation.
Kirtaniya Sadahari. It means Ananda Maya Purusha is the Lord because of repetition in the scripture. So in the Taittiriya Upanishad, there's a question about what is the goal of life, and Varuna is describing this to his son. He's describing like a pyramidal form. He's speaking about Atma, or Purusha, actually, because the word Purusha comes often, and Atma also. Anamaya Atmanam, Pranamayam Atmanam, Manomayam Atmanam, Vijnanamayam Atmanam, Anandamayam Atmanam. But he's also speaking about Anvayam Purusha Vida, Saiva Purusha Vida. So he's describing this gradation. Varuna. Varuna is teaching.
Who is he? Is he right?
Varuna is the god in the water. You know, he kidnaps.
It's
a demigod. Who? Yeah, Nandabhava.
But how did he come in the situation?
This Upanishad, the Taittiriya Upanishad, brings him up. You know, it's different. In Chandogya Upanishad, Sanat Kumara is instructing Narada Muni. Also, there's a name of Krishna, son of Devaki, also in the Chandogya Upanishad, being taught some Upanishad. So, Varuna is here instructing Brahman to his son, Brihu. And as Upanishads are doing, this is not the only place to describe it. They give different answer before giving the right answer. It can be a little confusing because you don't know why they're doing this. So it starts with anamaya. Ana is food. It's grain, but it's symbol for food. So Brahman is made of food. Because the body without food will die, then Brahman is made of food. Everything rests on food. This is the physical body. This is the gross body. Those who identify themselves with the body, they think that this is myself. And if I lose this body, then I lose everything. So it is terrible. Death is terrible for them, and old age also, because then they cannot, body doesn't function so well, and it's this pain in the joints, and pain, can't see, can't hear, cannot do anything, can't digest. It's coming to us. Yeah, Prabhupada was saying to his leading sannyasi when he was about to depart, don't think it's not going to happen to you. Because the biggest mystery in this world is to think that oh, I see death everywhere, but it's not going to happen to me. We always forget, we always think there's 30 years before, you know, me, or 40 or 50, depending on the age you're having, or maybe less. But we can die today. There's no guarantee. So, anamaya cannot describe the entire Brahman. So, pranamaya. Prana is breath. You can not eat food and continue to live for I don't know how many days, 40 days or even more. You can go on without eating food. Actually, I heard some people now, some practice, that they only live on breathing. They don't eat food at all for many years and they live on breathing. I don't know how they do it.
Druva.
No, today.
Druva
was doing it. Yes.
They look at the sun and they do like some energy with the sun.
Yeah.
But Druva did for 6 months.
6 months, but they do it for
years.
They do it for many years. I don't understand how it works. You know, they look at the sun and they get energy from the sun and they're breathing also.
6 months.
Okay. Prana. There's a story, this is Zen Buddhist story. It's okay for the story. Someone wants to know what is Satori, this Nirvana. So he goes to a Zen master. You know, Zen master, a little crazy. If you don't ask them this kind of question, you can expect anything. So he says, okay, come with me, because he came always asking him. So, Jaya Maharaj, Jaya Hare Krishna. So he says, come with me to the river. So they both come to the river and he says, look up there. Look. He says, you see the face? He says, come closer. So it comes closer. Then when it's just his face, the disciple's face is very close to the water, and the master takes his hand and plunges the head under the water. So for the first few seconds, no problem, no movement, nothing. He's thinking, oh, he's playing a joke on me. But after 30 seconds, then he starts seeing some vibration, he wants to get out. And after a good minute, he's really getting out, he wants to come out. And finally, the master releases the pressure, and he comes out and he breathes. And he says, the time when you will want to inquire about Nirvana or God, as much as you want to take breath, then you will be ready. You cannot live without
breathing.
When you will want to have this goal of life, the ultimate goal of life, be it God or Nirvana, as much as you want to have some vital air, then you'll be ready to get it, but not until then. So prana is the vital root of all life. When we check for someone who is still alive, we check his breathing. If he's not breathing, it's not a good sign at all. After that, we check the heart, but first breathing. So if he's not breathing, meaning that he's almost dead. And certainly if he hasn't breathed for the past few hours, he's certainly dead. So, pranamaya. But pranamaya is not, like I just said, you check also for the pulse and for the heart, because prana is not all of life. It is also a suggestion comparing Brahman to prana in later course of these sutras. But for now, this is a gradation going from anamaya, pranamaya, then manomaya. Manomaya means made of mind. We may not identify ourselves with the body, but we may live in our mind. Most of the time, we live in our mind. And when we're chanting, Gurudev was saying, and chanting Gayatri, your mind goes all over the universe. Then ultimately in deep sleep, but it goes everywhere. Because the mind can travel this quicker than light. You're thinking of your country already in your country. It's good when you're in your country and you're thinking of Brajdham, you're already there. But the other way around is not so good. If you're in Braj and you're thinking of your country, then it's not so good. The mind is a very powerful thing. Most people, everybody identify themselves with the mind. That's why it's so difficult to win an argument with anyone. Because everybody is convinced that they are right. Because they see it mentally like this, it cannot be otherwise. And it's very difficult to change someone's idea, especially when they've been thinking like this for many, many years. So mano mind. But this mind, of course, we see that the mind can also be the worst enemy. It can make us miserable when you have some really bad thought coming into your head and you cannot get rid of them, and the mind can make yourself feel really miserable. So I cannot describe the complete self. This is a subtle body, like pranamaya. Then the next one is vijnanamaya, translated differently. Some people say intelligence, but you cannot describe intelligence because there's a specific word for that. Vijnana is more like the consciousness. Consciousness in human being is actually giving you an idea of the soul. The soul is chitya, chit, it is conscious. So the consciousness is an identity. Actually, Sri Ramanujacharya is saying that all these different bodies representing the self, it's just like shells. Shells within a shell, and you're cracking the first shell, the second, the third. The first shell is actually the physical body. Anamaya is describing the physical body made of food, made of earth. Then you go with the subtle body, the more mind body, made of prana, made of mind, made also of not the consciousness, prana and mana. Then the third canal inside is Vijnanamaya, which according to Ramanujacharya describes the soul, Vijnana Atma, the individual soul.
Vijnana means realized.
Also, it can mean realized. Sanskrit words have various meaning.
But it can pertain to material realization or spiritual realization.
Yes. Vijnana also can mean consciousness, like this Vijnanavad Buddhism, like I was saying. Vijnanavad means the projection of your mind. Whatever you conceive of, this is the world that you see. That the world is only existing in your mind, in your imagination. It is a projection.
According to your level of realization. Or imagination.
And of course, according to the level of your realization. You're going to see people according to how you are yourself. If you're a thief, you're thinking everybody is a thief. And if you're a pure devotee, you're thinking everybody is a pure devotee. This is your state of consciousness. Srila Bhaktivedanta is describing in his Jivadharma all these different stages of consciousness, totally dull and gradually purifying self until the totally pure consciousness. And this Vishuddha Sattva, above all the sattva, the consciousness of being totally Vishuddha, then you have a clear consciousness. And Vedanta often identify liberation, moksha, with consciousness, pure consciousness. Brahman also, for the Mayavada at least, is only pure consciousness and nothing else. It's just a total above the mind, this has nothing to do, you know. Even if you speak about this Zen Buddhist who was speaking about that goal, it's only to be there, really there. Not in the past, not in the future, but really experiencing what you're experiencing there. You may ask them, is it something really wonderful, something really transcendental? No, it's just being there. Just experiencing the moment and fully being totally aware of the moment. It's not totally wrong. If we are fully there, chanting, then we are really absorbed in what we're doing. Most of the time, we are always in our mind. The mind is hovering off everywhere. And we have to be fixed in consciousness. This is the goal of yoga. Yoga, citta, vritti, nirodha. To stop all the fluctuation of the mind is the goal of yoga. And this goal of Bhakti Yoga also is to be totally absorbed. You have this different meditation. Meditation, you say, constantly, 24 hours a day. Yes, flowing constantly, no break. This is the idea that we come, this Lila Smaranam can become eventually part of our life, that we can hear them from Tridandi Maharaj. It's very great, all this different Lila. But then, at one point, they in our mind all the time, at one point we can even project ourselves and see ourselves in this in many years to come, maybe many lifetimes to come, to be in those lila. This is the idea, Vijnana Maya. Then the last level is Ananda Maya. Ananda actually is only for the Lord, says Ramanuja Acharya, Madhava Acharya, Baladevi Dibhushan, all the Vaishnava commentators, they say that it is only describing the Ananda Purusha, is the Supreme Lord. Krishna is only made of Ananda. Actually, it's interesting. Maharaj was speaking about the Brahmavihupi Mohan Lila. And when Brahma is seeing all the Vishnu form inside the little Gopa and the cows, this verse is there in the Bhagavatam. Satyam Gyana Ananta. This is coming from Upanishads. Satyam Gyana Ananta Brahma. From Taittiriya Upanishad, actually. Satyam Gyana Ananta. Ananda Matra Eka Rasa Murtaya. That he saw each of those deity as being full of bliss. Of course, the Satyam Gyanam Ananta, Satchitananda, and Ikaras, one Ras, Murti. Then he's also expressing, Aho Bhagyam, Aho Bhagyam, Nanda Gopala Prajokasam, Yad Mitram Paramanandam, Purnam Brahma Sanatanam, that Purna Brahma is Krishna, and he's this Nanda Gopa, the son of Nanda, is full of Ananda in Vrindavan. Nanda means bliss. Sunanda also means bliss. Abhinanda, Nanda Gopa, this is all full of Ananda. So Ananda is also in relationship with Rasa. The same Upanishad, Taittiriya Upanishad, is saying Rasa Vesa. That this Rasa is actually the goal. Rasa Jigyasa. It doesn't say this. I am saying Atato Rasa Jigyasa. Now is the time to inquire about Rasa. So some people are going to say, at last. We were waiting for this. Yes.
I have a question. You mentioned that this Ananda Maya is the Supreme Lord.
Yes.
I have always understood that also the jivas are made of Ananda, Satchitananda, but just minute quantity, whereas the Lord is unlimited quantity.
Yes. Why I'm saying this? Because Shankaracharya at first says Ananda Maya refers to the Supreme Lord, then a few sutras later saying, no, this is not true. It's only pertaining to the jiva. Because Ananda, Satchitananda, those are only words, and Brahman cannot be described by words and is above Ananda. This is always the same trick he's using. Is contradicting Śrīla Vyāsadeva, saying that Vyāsadeva has made a mistake or is not meaning to say this for the third time already. We're only in Sutra 13. For the third time, Śrīla Śaṅkaracārya is contradicting Śrīla Vyāsadeva and saying this doesn't represent the ultimate reality but only jīva or Brahman covered by this jīva conception. That it is above Brahman. And he's using arguments with the quotes from Taittiriya Upanishad because it says that it speaks about a Purusha. Brahman is described as a Purusha. Every time in the description of Anamaya Purusha, Pranamaya Purusha, Manomaya Purusha, it's always the form of a man. So he's saying Brahman cannot have the form of a man. So Ramanuja Acharya and Madhava Acharya are answering, why not? Then when Avatar comes, they have the form of a man. It's not because they come into this world, because this is the idea of Shankaracharya and his followers. When the Lord, when Brahman manifests as Avatar in this world, then it is covered by the material guna, the exact material quality and material body, and therefore it is subject to the laws of nature. But it's not. Why not? If it comes, if he's the creator, then he doesn't have to be subject to his own creation. This is always the argument Prabhupada was using. How can the creator can be the subject of his own creation? How can the... What to speak of becoming the slave of his creation? That is even more absurd. But if he comes as avatar, same thing. Why will he be covered by the material guna? He's the origin of all guna. He's making all these gunas. So why should he be covered by those gunas? This is the difficulty with the Mayavada philosophy. They cannot reconcile this. To them, Lord means physical body, mental mind, and so on and so forth. And Krishna is so tricky. And sometimes he's exhibiting also mental anxiety. You know, how am I going to save my little Gopa who enter into Agasura's mouth? How I'm going to save my father that, you know, the demon has kidnapped and he wants to kill, or he has said he has killed and he's lamenting, and so many different... And he literally has become bewildered. Not that he's pretending. His Lila Shakti is covering him, so literally he's forgetting.
So Rasa,
yes,
he enters his creation.
Yes.
He allows himself to be controlled by it.
And this Rasa is the meaning of Ananda Maya. Full of Ananda. He's controlled by Rasa. Ananda gives Rasa. And he can be a person. Why not? Then another argument of Shri Shankaracharya, he's saying that the end of this course is Brahma Pucham Pratishta. That the Brahman is situated Pratishta on the tail of that. Because every time it's described as a head, right side, left side. Like the former, okay, I read this. Higher than the Vijnana Maya Purusha is the Ananda Maya Purusha. This Purusha is filled with bliss. The Ananda Maya existence is a person. Like the former, this has the shape of a human, Purusha. His head is pleasure, his right side is joy, his left side is delight, and his Atma is bliss. Brahman is situated as the basis. So Shankaracharya is saying, well, Brahman is at the basis, so that cannot describe Brahman. But Krishna is saying in Bhagavad Gita, Brahmanohi Pratishtanam, same words. I am the basis of impersonal Brahman. So what is wrong with this? Then Shankaracharya is also saying that Maya, the suffix Maya, means not made of, but modification, vikar. But Badarayan Srila Vyasadeva is saying vikara shabdan neti chen, that's the sutra next chapter. Vikara shabdan neti chen, na prashurya. If one argues that the suffix Maya means transformation, that argument is not correct, since the suffix means inherent abundance. Krishna is full of bliss, and this bliss is abundant. It is actually unlimited. Ananda, Shinmaya, Ras, Pratbhavitabhis, all of these gopis come and they increase all this bliss that he has in himself. Full of rasa, full of ananda. And it goes on, a few more sutra. I put this sutra 17. Beda Vyapadesh Cha. Interesting, this Beda Vyapadesh appears in the sutra at least 10, 11 times. You know what Beda means? Difference. How Shankaracharya has not noticed that this Beda Vyapadesh keep on coming back? The subject of the mantra is not the jiva because of statements indicating the opposite. And this Beda Vyapadesh appears many times in the Vedanta Sutra, saying there is difference between jiva and Brahman. Yes, jiva is also Satchitananda in the minute form, but it's certainly not Purna Brahman. Whatever comes from us, like offsprings, like if we have children, they are not similar to us. They don't diminish us. Yeah, they diminish us a little bit. Children diminish us. Anyway, you cannot apply this Om Purnamada Purnamidam to ourselves. This is Purna Brahma. We are Anu Brahma. This is the difference between Brahma that I say Aham Brahmasmi, and when Krishna say Brahmanohi Pratishta Aham, that is a totally different thing. It is later described in the second chapter how Jiva cannot be full Brahma. You're not the creator. How can you pretend that this creation depends on you? When we die, the world doesn't change, it continues. Without us, it doesn't even notice our death, usually. Unless we are famous and this is in the newspaper, or infamous also, this is also in the newspaper. But otherwise, people will forget. That is a sad truth. Will be forgotten. We all want to have a big samadhi with a big title, you know, grace, and so on and so forth, Ananda something. But actually, no, we're just passing through. This world is not the permanent world, and it's nothing to lament. Krishna is saying in Bhagavad Gita, this is Anu Vedanta, beginning Vedanta, he's saying that this world is always changing. You come to birth, then you die, it's a natural thing. There's nothing to lament. He keeps on saying, don't lament, don't worry. It means nothing. And once you get the full picture, it's actually great. Also, it's described in Vedanta Sutra, second chapter, why this world was created. Only for Leela. Leela, Kevalyam, only for Leela, not yours. We are thinking, oh, God is so cruel, He didn't make the world perfect, meaning according to my desire, because if it is perfect, I have my own definition of perfection. So, He didn't make the world for me, and the world has been made for our enjoyment. But this is only we saying this, human beings. We are thinking the world has been made for our enjoyment, but it has not been made for our enjoyment. It's been made for Krishna's enjoyment. Leela tu eva kevalyam. He's the one enjoying creation. He's the one descending avatar to enjoy also with us. Oh, he gives us also some satisfaction, mundane satisfaction if you want. But not only this. Ultimately, how the world is working has nothing to do with what you want. You probably noticed from now. You probably notice that it's usually not according to your wish. And this is very frustrating. Like, I wanted to have this kind of life and I had this life instead. I wanted to have this wife or this husband and I got nothing or I got the wrong person. Why? So devotees in their wisdom say, this is your karma, Prabhu, which is bite the bullet, whatever.
You be one. All others should be perfect. But I should be, everyone should accept me.
Yes, that is the principle. That is Godhood principle. God doesn't have to endeavor for anything, but everybody else should work according to his wish. So we think of God. Actually, God, He gives our independence as we want. And ultimately, even the suffering is His mercy. This, whatever I am suffering is the mercy of the Lord, because I should have suffered much greater, but He has minimized my suffering. And on top of this, He has given me a slap in the head in order for me to go a little further. The world is perfect. It is not as people describe, oh, it's getting worse and worse. No, you're getting worse and worse. The world is okay. The world is actually a living entity. You know, this, those New Age people, they call it Gaia. You know, it's an entity. But actually, it's true. It is an entity. You cannot destroy the world. It doesn't mean that we should not be worried about pollution. The other day, it was 20 dead turtles on the sea because of those boats, you know, that hit them. It's horrible. It's horrible. But at the same time, somehow nature is working to accommodate all of foolishness and still surviving. So the world is perfect because it's come from the perfect. Om Purnamada Purnamidam. This is how Srila Prabhupada translates. This phenomenal world coming from the perfect person is also perfect because the person is perfect. So everything is perfect. Only our conception of the world, our wishes are not in tune with this world. And therefore, this brings suffering. But what is the goal of our life, and what is the goal of our philosophy? You said it, Ananda. We want happiness, that's what everybody wants. We don't want to be miserable. Unless you're really desperate, you don't want to be miserable or crazy. Even people would jump from mountain top, you know, this extreme sport they do. I don't understand why, but they jump from top of the buildings, you know, the parachute that will open at the last minute, or they go in Alaska, they come by plane and they drop on ski and they go down the mountain, and sometimes there's a big snow, you know, avalanche coming, you know, and they're going to get completely covered, or they do all kinds of crazy things. Why are they doing this? They call them daredevil. They don't want to die, they want excitement. Their life is so boring that they want to have excitement, ananda, at the risk of their own life.
Actually, it's just adrenaline.
It is adrenaline. But it's...
For them, it's an adrenaline.
It is. Yeah. Like, wow, I know, you don't
when
understand.
They survive, it's bliss.
Yeah. Huh?
When they survive, it's bliss.
Mm-hmm. Even when they live, that's what they do it. The fear of death, of challenge of death, is exciting. It's like a great pleasure. It's like also the heroin addict is risking his life every time he's shooting himself.